So this morning I'm going to preach a message called There Are Still Jerichos on the Other Side of Jordan. Amen? Amen. We're going to turn real quick. Well, you know, you can turn with me to Joshua chapter 6. And actually we're going to go ahead and read. Let's go ahead and read the whole chapter. I keep reminding you that Paul told young Timothy, the pastor, to give attention to the public reading of Scripture. Amen? Because all Scripture, according to what the Apostle Paul said, is profitable. It's profitable for doctrine, meaning instruction. It's profitable for reproof and to bring correction in people's lives. Amen? So we want to stay close to the Scriptures, and this is the story that we're going to pretty much be preaching about. So let's go ahead and just read the whole chapter. It says now, so we're in Joshua chapter 6, starting at verse 1. If you don't have a King James version of the Bible, we have some back there, just so that you can, you know, I don't know about you, but I've tried to read a different version than what the preacher was reading, and it just makes it difficult. But, you know, if that's what you want to do, that's cool. Now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shalt thou do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day you shall compass the city 7 times. And the priest shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when ye hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up every man straight before him. And Joshua the son of Nun called the priests and said unto them, take up the ark of the covenant, and let 7 priests bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord. And he said unto the people, pass on and compass the city, and let him that is armed pass on before the ark of the Lord. And it came to pass, when Joshua had spoken unto the people, that the 7 priests, bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns, passed on before the Lord, and blew with the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed men went before the priests that blew with the trumpets, and the rear reward came after the ark, the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, you shall not shout, nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout. Then shall you shout. So the ark of the Lord compassed the city, going about it once, and they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua arose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord. And 7 priests bearing 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew with the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the rear reward came after the ark of the Lord and the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And the 2nd day they compassed the city once and returned into the camp. And so they did for 6 days. And it came to pass on the 7th day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and compassed the city after the same manner 7 times. Only on that day they compassed the city 7 times. And it came to pass at the 7th time, when the priests blew with the trumpets, Joshua said unto the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. And the city shall be accursed even in it, and all that are therein to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all that are in with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. And ye in any wise keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest you make yourselves accursed when you take of the accursed thing, and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So the people shouted when the priests blew with the trumpets. And it came to pass, when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, and ox and sheep, and ass with the edge of the sword, which is another word for donkey. I'm glad we read this, because, you know, I need to explain a little bit. Whenever we get to this part, Don't let me forget. Let's just stop for a second, because let's look at that. I mean, come on. What kind of a God do you serve anyway, Christian? You ever ran into that whenever you're talking to people about Jesus? And they say, what kind of a God would destroy both man, woman, young and old, and ox and sheep? They're going to kill the children, they're going to kill the young, and they're going to kill the old and feeble. What kind of a God is that? Well, I'm going to explain to you why here in a little bit whenever we talk about that. I'm going to explain to you why God would have something like that to be done. And to be honest with you, for the longest time as a young Christian, because of the fact that pastors don't want to preach some of the things that I'm about to talk to you about this morning, I was clueless to little pieces and gaps of details in the Bible, why it was the way that it was. But God has a purpose and a reason for wanting things done a certain way. Amen? Right. And there was a reason why he wanted this done. Yes. It's not because he's a cruel God. Right. No. It's because there's things going on behind the scenes that if you're not aware of, then you need to understand, then it can destroy your life.
That's right.
All right. And so he goes on to say in verse 22, but Joshua had said unto the two men that had spied out the country, go into the harlot's house and bring out thence the woman and all that she has, as you swore unto her. And the young men that were spies went in and brought out Rahab and her father and her mother and her brethren and all that she had. And they brought out all her kindred and left them without the camp of Israel. And they burnt the city with fire and all that was therein, only the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and of iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. And Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive and her father's household and all that she had. And she dwelleth in Israel even unto this day, because she hid the messengers which Joshua sent to spy. And you know, I got to stop again, because I didn't plan on telling you this, but if you go back and you read the genealogy of Jesus in the book of Matthew, amen, I'm pretty sure it's in the book of Matthew, what the conclusion that you're going to come to is that Rahab the harlot lies in the genealogy of Jesus, amen. It was Rahab that gave birth, if I'm not mistaken, to Boaz, and it was Boaz that married Ruth, another Gentile woman that came from Moab, and Ruth gave birth to Obed, and Obed gave birth to Jesse, and Jesse gave birth to David, amen, who would become the king of Israel and a type of Jesus Christ, amen, which would foreshadow the coming king, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, which will rule for all eternity, because God said, I've set up his throne and it's an everlasting throne, amen. It's never going to perish. It's never going to fade away. You need to understand, I don't know what you're in going through this morning. I don't know what Ballard said it. Failure is going to happen in the life of the believer. I mean, you need to understand that God uses people that aren't perfect. And hallelujah. God used a harlot named Rahab, and he not only did he use her and he delivered her out of this destruction that happened on this day, but he also used her in the genealogy of Jesus. You've never gone too far and you've never messed up so bad that God can't use you. He's in the restoration business. He's not done with you. Amen. Yes. Just trust him and let it work in your life. Hallelujah. All right. It's important that you know that God used Rahab.
Yes.
Goes on to say in verse 25, and Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive and her father's household and all that she had, and she dwelleth in Israel even unto this day. Verse 26, and Joshua adjured them at the time, saying, cursed be the man before the Lord that riseth up and buildeth this city Jericho. He shall lay the foundation thereof in his firstborn, and in his youngest son shall he set up the gates of it. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame was noised throughout all the country. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your precious word, Lord. Your word, Lord God, it endures time. Lord, the grass withers, the flower fades, oh Lord, but your word endures forever. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, I yield my tongue to you. Lord, I yield my tongue to you, and I pray that you would fill my mouth, oh Lord God, with the words. Lord, you've chosen to use the foolishness of preaching, Lord, to confound the wise. You've chosen to use the mortal clay that you formed out of the dust of this earth, oh Lord God, and it became fallen along with Adam, oh Lord, but nevertheless, you have chosen, Lord God, to fill this broken clay, oh Lord God, with your spirit, Lord, and you touch the hearts of men, Lord, and you call them to preach preach your gospel, Lord. As men, we're unworthy to speak forth for you, but I pray, Lord God, you've chosen to use it this way, to do it this way. So I pray, Lord, that you'd fill my mouth with your words this morning, not the words of a man, Lord God, but instead the word of God, so that it would come forth, Lord, and that it would minister to your people, because you know where they are, Lord, and you know what they need, Lord God. And I pray, oh Lord, that you would do your work in our hearts, Lord, that we might bring you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, listen, the way that we got started in this journey was, if you'll remember, we read last week out of 2 Kings chapter 2. And what I did was, in 2 Kings chapter 2, there's a story about a prophet named Elijah. Some people are like, well, why are we talking about Jericho whenever you were talking about the prophet Elijah? Well, I'm going to explain it to you again so that you remember where we were. In the 2 Kings narrative, God is about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elijah, along with Enoch, are the only two men noted in the Bible that never died, never saw death. Amen. The scripture teaches us that in the end days, there's going to be two witnesses that show up. This is just Lanya. And many scholars believe that it'll be Elijah and Enoch, because the word of God says it's appointed unto man once to die, yes, and then the judgment. Those two men haven't died yet. Those two witnesses will show up according to the scriptures. They will preach the gospel in the end times. They will die. Their bodies will be laying in the street. And after 3.5 days, they will be resurrected and brought up to heaven. Hallelujah. But nevertheless, in the story, Elijah, who has already done mighty works, amen, for the kingdom of God, he's been a prophet of God. He's been speaking forth the truth of God's word. It's not that there were no other prophets in the land. As a matter of fact, if you go back and you read the story, every time Elijah and Elisha on this little journey that they're taking stop, it seems like there's a whole school of prophets there. And that these school of these prophets are telling Elisha every time they stop, hey, did you know that the Lord's going to take your master away today? And Elisha doesn't really want to hear what it is that they're saying. He's wanting to stay focused on the fact and follow after his master. And one of the things that was interesting to me is that it seemed as though Elijah was being represented as a type of Christ. And the reason that I say that is because in John 14, Jesus told his disciples, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go away to prepare a place for you. If it wasn't so, I would not tell you. I come back for you again. Amen. A paraphrase. And his disciples were already sorrowful of heart with the fact that their master was leaving. In a similar fashion, Elijah is leaving, and Elisha represents a type of the disciple, a learner of Christ. And Elijah tells Elisha, you don't even have to follow me on this journey, because you see, Elijah was about to go on a journey on that day before the whirlwind came and took him to be in heaven. And he says, they started off their travels in a place called Gilgal. And the first stop in the journey was a place called Bethel. And Elijah told Elisha, you don't have to come with me. You can tarry right here. And Elisha said, no, as long as there's light in your soul, I will not stay right here, but instead I will follow along with you. And so on this journey, there was some various stops along the way. There was a place, they started at a place called Gilgal, and the first place they went was to a place called Bethel. We preached on those two spots last week, amen? The next spot they're going to go to today is Jericho, and then lastly they'll go to the Jordan River. And so what we're going to talk about this morning has to do with Jericho. But what I wanted you to see is that on this journey, at each one of these spots, are very significant things that have taken place in the history of Israel. The scripture doesn't say it. In my heart and in my opinion, the reason why this journey had to take place was because God had told Elijah that Elisha was to take his place as a prophet of God. And once again, you would say, well, what's the big deal? There were all kinds of prophets. The big deal is that there were a lot of prophets, but nobody was speaking the truth. And the same thing that was happening in Israel of old is also happening in the church today. There's a lot of prophets or preachers, but there's not a whole lot of people that are preaching the truth of God's word. Amen? And so you can have a whole bunch of them, but if they're not telling the truth, then the people perish because they're not being instructed in the right ways of God. And so it was important for Elisha to be reminded that there was a God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that he had a plan. And each time they stopped, or each place they started along the way, there's a history behind each one of these locales. It may not mean much to you. It wouldn't have meant much to me had I not known it. If we don't know the history of God, then it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything, if you will, to a young American that doesn't understand that people had to shed their blood in order for them to be able to live in some semblance of freedom. Right? It doesn't mean anything to them. As a matter of fact, well, I don't even know why this comes into my head, but I can remember whenever the last president became president, and the next thing you know, they had people on TV that said, they're going to give me a house. They're going to give me a house because this new president became president, and now everything that we're going to get is just going to be laid to us on the silver platter. That was the mindset. We're just going to be given all of these things. Nobody understands that the reason that you can even go to work and get a job and earn whatever the case is because of the Constitution and the way that this thing was set up. And the reality of it is that it's the same thing for the child of God. We need to understand that the God in heaven, amen, is the one that gives us the victory. He's the one that opens up the doors. Yeah. And then listen, we need to understand, just as Elisha needed to be reminded, that there was a history behind what God was doing. God's working on this earth. Amen. God's got a plan.
Amen.
And Elisha, if he's going to take Elijah's place as a prophet, needs to be reminded about the plan of God. The first place where they started was a place called Gilgal. Now, I got to tell you that if you remember anything about the history, so this is where we are in our story. We're right here about 900 B.C. Time frame of the kings. Saul's already been king. David's already been king. Now the northern part of Israel is split in two. The nation of Israel has been split in two because of Solomon's disobedience. I don't have time to get into all that, but if you read the Bible, you remember that. And now Ahab is king of the northern part of Israel. He was a wicked king. You remember he was married to Jezebel. And Elijah is the prophet of God, and it's about 900 B.C. But whenever they take their journey, the first place that they stop is in a place called Gilgal. Now, Gilgal was having to do with the time frame of Joshua, which is about 1400 B.C. So we're looking at about somewhere around 500 years of history. We're doing a flashback, if you will. Amen? And so what happened at this place called Gilgal is that God had created a nation. They had been slaves in Egypt. And then on that night, at the Passover night, you remember the story, on the Passover, what does that even mean to you? Do you know the story of the Passover? That God told Moses that you'll take a lamb, and you're going to cut its throat, and you'll collect its blood, and you're going to paint its blood on the doorpost of your home. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Judgment's coming through the land, and it's about to strike Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. Pharaoh is a type of Satan. Judgment is coming on the world. God said that you must take your lamb, paint your doorpost with blood, and you must take that lamb, roast it in fire. Fire representative of judgment, the lamb representative of Jesus. Jesus took our judgment on the cross, and you're going to eat the lamb. Amen. Jesus said, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood. Spiritually speaking, nutrition-wise, you got to grab a hold of Jesus and what he did for you at the cross, and he's got to be your daily nutrition. Hallelujah. Each and every day, so that you can be strengthened and receive the grace that you need from God.
Yes.
And if you're willing to stay in the house and eat the lamb, then guess what? Judgment will pass over you. And so that's what happened on that Passover night. But then what happened? Well, after the Exodus, there's a wandering in the wilderness, going in circles. You ever been walking in circles before with God? Come on, somebody. You ever been in the wilderness?
Right.
The struggle is real. Amen. And so there they go. They wander in the wilderness over and over again. Same old mistakes. Longing back towards Egypt. Oh, the leeks. Oh, the garlic. Oh, the melons. Oh, the onions. Oh, how good the world was to me. It just tasted so good and it felt so good. And I just got to go back and I don't want to move forward. But you know what? God has a way, hallelujah, of getting a hold of his people. Don't let me get ahead of myself. But before they were going to move into the promised land under the leadership of Joshua, somewhere about right here, there was this place called Gilgal. And the word Gilgal means the reproach has been rolled away. Remember how I told you the word rolled away was almost like if you could see a cart with a wheel on it. And all of a sudden, the cart's traveling in one direction, but then one of the wheels comes off, and it just starts rolling off, and it's rolling in another direction, and it just rolls into the horizon to the point where you don't see it anymore. What God did at Gilgal was he made them recircumcise themselves. Now, what you got to understand about circumcision was that it was the sign of the covenant. It was the covenant, sign of the covenant that God had with Israel even before there was a nation called Israel, when he called this man named Abraham out from Ur of the Chaldees. God called a man named Abraham out before there ever was a nation called Israel, and he told this man, see, some of you might not be used to my kind of teaching, but if you hang around long enough, you're going to know about Abraham and circumcision and covenant so well, amen, that it'll just be part of your talk. You'll be talking about it at the breakfast table.
Amen.
And so this is what it happens is that for 40 years, the Word of God says that the children of Israel walked in a state where they were uncircumcised. Meaning that they walked outside of covenant with God. They weren't walking in covenant with God. God said, if you're going to enter into the land of promise that I have made for you, then you're going to recircumcise yourself. You're going to enter back into covenant with me. What does covenant mean, by the way? What does that mean to me today, preacher? How can this help me in my walk with God? Covenant essentially means agreement. You need to understand something. God has an agreement with you. Amen? God has an agreement with you, and his agreement is that he's going to send Jesus. Come on, somebody. It don't get any better than this. Oh, man, all that preacher did was preach about Jesus and the cross. God has an agreement with man. Man is fallen, and he's all messed up, and God has one way that he's going to bring access back into his presence, and he's not going to change his mind.
Amen.
And his agreement says, you cannot get to me, but I'm going to make a way for you to get to me. And all of this time in the Old Testament, God is bringing Messiah, which we now know was Jesus, Messiah the Anointed One. He's bringing Messiah to humanity, and now in the New Testament, he's bringing humanity to Messiah. We are going to have to bow at the cross, or we will not have access to the grace of God. And so just as the children of Israel wandered in a wilderness, walking in the flesh, if you will. Why in the flesh? Because they were walking outside of covenant. They refused to circumcise themselves. And many times after you and I have had our Red Sea experience, our Passover night experience, where we gave our life to Jesus, we find ourselves wandering in a wilderness, walking in the flesh, struggling and looking back at Egypt, wishing that we were still holding on to and receiving the things of the world. And the Lord said, you go to Gilgal, because this is the day that the reproach of Egypt will be removed from you.
Amen.
We're going to talk about Jordan next week. I need you to know we're going to talk about Jordan next week. And if the Red Sea represents our salvation, then the crossing of the Jordan represents our sanctification. Real simple this morning, I want you to know something, that whenever you cross through the Red Sea, in the mind of God, you are already saved and you are already delivered. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Lord's already done his work.
Amen.
The Word of God says that Jesus sat down.
Yes.
His work is a completed work. God's convinced of it. The crossing of the Jordan is more for you and me to become convinced of what God's already convinced of. See, it takes a wilderness of a trial. It takes a wilderness of a temptation to bring the child of God through there so that his mind will finally line up with God's mind.
Amen.
So that, listen to me, if you love Jesus and the love of God is in your heart, you may find yourself, like Ballard said, venturing off from time to time, finding yourself in a place of failure. But listen, God knows how to get your heart and your mind to line up with his heart and his mind to the place where you say, I don't want it, Lord. I don't want it because it's going to destroy me and it's going to destroy my relationship with you. God wants you and I to cross over the Jordan, and he wants us to move into the promised land of rest.
Amen.
But what I need you to know is this, that on the other side of Jordan, there's still some Jerichos. Don't think that there still are strongholds to be dealt with even once your mind lines up with God's mind. The enemy of your soul is relentless. He will not quit. He desires to destroy you and to destroy your walk with God. He brought him to Gilgal. That's where they started off in Elijah and Elisha's journey. That was the place where, I guarantee you, you don't tell me that Elisha and Elijah were at Gilgal, even though it was 500 years before, and they didn't remember what had happened at Gilgal 500 years before that. Amen?
Amen.
Every 4th of July, we remember what happened so long ago.
Uh-huh.
Truth of the matter is that this was significant for them. Then they go to Bethel. We talked about Bethel, and what we said about Bethel was is that the patriarch Jacob, Abraham's grandson, Abraham had a son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob.
Jacob had deceived his brother Esau for the birthright,
and he was on the run. He was on heading towards Haran, I believe it was, where Abraham was from to find himself a bride, Rebekah. And on his journey, he stops at a place and he finds a stone and he lays his head upon that stone. And that night, the heavens opened up. He had a dream. There was a ladder. And on this ladder, the angels of God were ascending and descending. There was an open heaven. And when Jacob woke up, he said, "This place is the house of God. This is surely the gate of heaven." An open heaven. A place where man can see an open heaven. A place where mankind can access the God of glory. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that has a plan. And he told Jacob, he said, "I have a plan for you and your seed. And it's through your seed that all nations of the earth will be blessed." And that seed was ultimately Jesus. And listen to me. We learn in John chapter 1 verse 51 that Jesus told Nathanael, he said, "When I saw you under the fig tree," is where I saw you under the fig tree, Nathanael. And Nathanael said, "Oh, you're the Son of God." And Jesus said, I'm paraphrasing. You're impressed with that? Well, what you're about to see is the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. See, the truth of the matter is that Jesus is really Jacob's ladder. Jesus is the real access to an open heaven. The Lord said that I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. If you need access to the presence of God tonight, hallelujah. If you need access for God to move and operate in your life, keep your eyes focused on Jesus. Keep your eyes focused on the fact that His work is a finished work, yes, and that He is the one that opens heaven for you,
right,
and gives you access to the grace of God. Listen, grace isn't just for your forgiveness. Grace is for your strength. Grace is for your power. You need to learn to trust in the Lord and what He's done. He's gone before you. So those were the two first stops. It was Gilgal and Bethel. And now we're at Jericho, and we read the story. Look at verse 1 of Jericho, Joshua chapter 6. It says, "Now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel." Now, we understand that Jericho was a fortified city. It was made with these, I would imagine, monstrous walls. I'm quite certain that the inhabitants of Jericho trusted in their walls. Amen. And that, but nevertheless, we see here in this first verse some telling information. It says that the city was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. Nobody went out. Nobody came in. That means that there's some fear that's taking place. The inhabitants of Jericho are scared or afraid because of the children of Israel. We have to go back a few chapters to find out why. Joshua chapter 2. Rahab the harlot explains to us why the inhabitants of Jericho are living in fear because of the children of Israel. The word of the Lord teaches us in Joshua chapter 2 that Joshua sent two spies to Jericho to find out the story of what's going on in the city. They go into Rahab's house, the harlot, and the city's aware of the fact that two Israel men go to Rahab the harlot's house. And actually, they go and tell the king, and the king goes and questions Rahab, and Rahab says, "Oh yeah, they came, but they're gone now." And so they go to pursue for these men. But the reality is that Rahab hid them on her rooftop. She had some bundles, it seems, of wheat or barley of some sort. And she hid them amongst these bundles. But then before she goes to bed, she goes and talks to them. And it says right here in verse 8, of chapter 2. "Before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. She said unto the men, 'I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you.'" The word faint means to become dissolved. It means to be weakened. You ever been weakened in your knees before? The reality of it is that fear can grip your heart. Fear can grip your heart and cause you to become weak in your knees. It says in verse 10, "For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you, for the Lord your God, He is God in heaven above and in earth beneath." Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that you will also show kindness unto my father's house. Skip down to verse 15. It says, then she let them down by a cord through the window, for her house was upon the town wall, and she dwelt upon the wall. And she said unto them, get ye to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there 3 days, until the pursuers be returned. And afterward, may we go your way. You may go your way. Verse 17, and the men said unto her, we will be blameless of this thine oath, which thou hast made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, that thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window, which thou didst let us down by. And thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brethren and all thy father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whatsoever shall go out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head, and we will be guiltless. And whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on your head, if any hand be upon him. Now listen, I just wanted to, this is the first point I want to make. It's called the scarlet thread. The first point I want to make has to do with Rahab the harlot's scarlet thread. We see that Jericho is full of fear. The city is shut up, and we had to go back and find out from Rahab what the reasoning was behind this. This is also going to answer to some extent the question on why God would tell his people, when you enter into that city, I want you to destroy everything in there. I want you to destroy the old. I want you to destroy the young. I want you to destroy their animals. And what I want you to know is this. Is that there's the top store and then the bottom store, and you can see the line. And I drew something over here. There's a place called Bashan over here. And you see it's on this side of the Jordan River. This is the Sea of Galilee. This is the Dead Sea. This is the Jordan River. This is Bashan. It's the top store right there. This is Jericho. It's this bottom store. It's approximately the right spot. Bashan, she mentioned a man named Og. Did you see that? She said King Og. Bashan right here was on this side of the Jordan. This side of the Jordan is the wilderness journey. And they're about to cross over the Jordan, and Jericho is right there on the other side. As a matter of fact, in the real story, whenever Israel crossed over, they crossed over first, and the first stronghold that they found was Jericho. The Word of God says that so Bashan is on this side, and Jericho's on this side. There's a crossing over that's taking place. But what I want you to see is that 22 times this man Og is mentioned in the Old Testament. And I have this little graphic right here because I want to talk to you a little bit about who Og was. The Word of God says, and we'll look at two different scriptures that talk about it, that Og's bed was, if I'm not mistaken, 14 cubits long and 6 cubits wide. If I'm wrong, I got the scripture next and we'll look at it. The Bible teaches that he was a giant in the way of Goliath. I don't know if these numbers are right, but the way that they have them is that Og and Goliath would have been somewhere between, really the scripture says Goliath was about 9 feet tall, but somewhere between probably 9 to 12 feet tall. Some people go as far as for saying 18 feet on Og, but I don't really see that being the number there. But they're basically about the size, almost twice the size of a normal man. And one of the reasons that I wanted to talk to you a little bit about this was because you need to understand spiritually in your life that many times there's giants that stand in the way between you and the promises of God and the victory of God moving and operating in your life. Yes. They keep on reoccurring. There were giants on this side of the Jordan River, and there's also giants on that side. I can assure you that the reason that God wants everyone in Jericho destroyed is because some of this giant seed was in some of the inhabitants of those that lived in Jericho. How did the giants show up? Well, you got to go back to Genesis chapter 6. The Word of God says that the sons of God, all the preacher don't want to preach this. You're going to freak out my people. It's time for the people to be freaked out. It's time for the people to be awakened and that their eyes be opened and that they understand that they're at war.
Preach it, brother.
The sons of God came into the daughters of men. Sons of God, according to the book of Job, were fallen angels that presented themselves along with Satan to God to give an account for what they had been doing. I don't have time to get into all the details on how it happened. I don't know exactly how it happened. I do know that the author of Hebrews said, when you entertain strangers, be careful, for some have entertained angels unaware. That means that angels can shapeshift and come into the form of a human being, so much so that you and I don't even understand or know that that's the case.
Right.
Somehow the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and the Word of God says in the book of Genesis chapter 6 that there were giants in the land. The word is Nephilim. And that, listen to me, they were there before the flood, but they were also there after the flood. As a matter of fact, we did a teaching on this, and I know that I've said this a lot here recently, but I think it's very paramount because, you know, the Word of God says that just as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days when the Son of Man returns. What I'm trying to tell you is that fallen angels and cohabiting and joining in union with humanity is major occult black magic work. And if you think that that kind of stuff isn't still going on today, where the enemy of our soul is behind the scenes causing all kind of confusion and chaos, listen to me. Do you think that that name ISIS came out of nowhere on accident? Really? This isn't in my notes, but we need to talk about it. Have you done any research on the past and the archaeology and the hieroglyphics on Egyptian walls and the story of ISIS and the story of Osiris and the story of Horus, who is the sun, who is a counterfeit form of what they would say Jesus? And the fact of the matter is that the occult world is waiting for a false Christ to show up. And what I need you to know is that name ISIS didn't show up out of anywhere. Listen to me. Do you think that it's just accidental? You don't have to believe me if you don't want to, but just go ahead and humor the preacher for a second, because I want to try to put some little seeds in your mind. And I want you to do what you want with the seeds. You can take them out and you can throw them in the garbage on the way home, or you can think about it for a little bit and wonder, is it possible? Is it possible that what he's saying could be true? We understand that the spirit of Antichrist is behind cutting people's heads off, don't we?
Yes.
That's
what the Word of God said.
That's right.
Yes.
You think it's accidental that that's what the drug cartels were doing in Mexico, that all of a sudden out of nowhere just the spirit of Antichrist decided to start making people cut people's heads off?
Yeah. I've been doing that for centuries.
Yeah. You think that it's accidental that ISIS just sprung up out of nowhere and that their name is ISIS and that they're cutting people's heads off? See, what I'm trying to tell you is that, yes, it's the spirit of Antichrist that's behind it. But what I'm trying to tell you is that I'm about to take it a step further. I'm telling you that it's not an accident. I'm telling you that it's not just some accidental, unorganized thing where the spirit of Antichrist is moving upon men's hearts and, oh, I think I'll cut somebody's head off. No. I'm trying to tell you that behind the scenes, I believe that there's an organized network where the enemy of our soul is using human beings to come against mankind and to strike fear. Do you understand that there are people that are so powerful on the earth that own the banking industry? Listen to me. I said this last Thursday whenever we were doing the teaching of the book of Revelation, that the man named George Soros, that Glenn Beck, you don't preach this on Sunday mornings except at this church. A man named George Soros that Glenn Beck called out on Fox News and then lost his job was a multi-billionaire that was behind that whole Wall Street debacle. Remember that? Whenever all those people started camping out on Wall Street, we just thought everybody just decided to show up one day. Oh, let's live in tents and micturate. You'll have to Google that word. It's number one. We'll just do number one wherever we want in the streets. We'll all live in tents. We'll make the whole place stench like, you know, human waste. And we'll do whatever we want to do. We'll shut down Wall Street. And we just thought that all of a sudden, the spirit of Antichrist caused everybody to converge on the scene and to ruin everything that was going on, when in reality, Glenn Beck began to do some research and he carried it all the way back to George Soros, the multi-billionaire, had funded this situation and caused all of this thing to take place. Well, I did a little bit of research on George Soros for myself, and I found out he worked for the Rothschild family. The Rothschild family owns the banking industry. We don't have time to get into that. The fact that people would swear that they were Luciferians, that they worship the enemy of your soul, and in return that they've been given power and dominion upon this earth for a period of time in order to cause confusion to take place, in order to bring in, as a matter of fact, they're the ones, I didn't plan any of this, sorry, that started the whole Illuminati thing that everybody's talking about. In the 1700s, A man named Adam Weishaupt was hired by the Rothschild family to start the Illuminati in order to bring in the age-old Luciferian doctrines of bringing mankind under subjection, just as at the Tower of Babel, to bring mankind under one new world order. And since the time frame of the confusion of the languages, the spirit of Antichrist has continued to try to move humanity back to a new world order. And if I started naming some of the politicians that are behind this, it caused some of y'all to shiver in your chairs, because some of you have been so politically active, and I gotta tell you that it's the very politicians that you thought were the ones you were supposed to vote in that are really the ones behind the scene that are causing all the problems. You're not gonna fix it in a voting booth. We need to understand that there's corruption. I'm not telling you don't go vote. That's not what I'm telling you. What I'm telling you is that I guarantee you there's evidence out there where you will see it spoken out of their own mouth. We're over here so blinded thinking that because of the agenda of, oh, they're pro-life, they're pro-heterosexual marriage, they're pro, that they tell you one thing coming out of their mouth, but they do something else behind the scenes.
That's right.
I'm not even going to be able to preach my message this morning. Listen to me. How is it that Obamacare can pass? Come on.
That's right.
And listen, I don't have any reason to fuss about this. I got a pay raise whenever Obamacare passed. How is it that Obamacare can pass when you have a Supreme Court split up 5 conservative, 4 liberal? How is it that 5 conservatives were appointed by conservative presidents, and that's what we've been told politically, to vote for conservative presidents so that they'll put those conservative Supreme Court justices in there, but yet at the same time it takes the head guy of the Supreme Court to give the final vote, and he was also a conservative, and it swung at 5-4 and Obamacare passed? How is it that same-sex marriage also did the same thing?
That's right.
5-4. And it required 5 conservative judges appointed by conservative presidents. Come on, somebody. There's something that doesn't smell right here. You might not be able to see it, but I'm starting to catch on that there's something going on. And what I'm trying to tell you is that the same spirit that was behind Wall Street in an organized fashion with multi-billionaire, he's just a pawn in the big game. He's just a little pawn. He's the one. Listen, you think that something that Greece's economy just fell? This dude, I saw him on a video 3 years ago. He caused Greece's economy to collapse 3 years ago. The same guy, George Soros. And he just works for the Rothschilds. What I'm trying to tell you is that I believe money was funneled into the drug cartels. Listen to me. The top guy, you tell your boys, cut off heads and we'll make sure you're taken care of. The same thing goes with ISIS. Just rise up out of nowhere. Come on. Yes, I believe that the enemy will use Islam in the last days. He is right now. It goes back to the horses of Revelation.
Yeah.
I don't even know how he got here, but he goes back to the horses of Revelation. A red horse, a white horse, a pale horse, which in the Greek is chloros, which means green, the colors of the Muslim flags. The enemy of our soul will use Islam in the last days to exact fear and strike fear in the hearts of humanity on the globe, instituting chaos around the world. It's interesting also that the same colors of the Mexican flag.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Right.
Instituting chaos and fear along the world. And all of a sudden, now we need a leader. We need a leader that will, and for the nations to come together, because we got to have peace. And I showed you last Thursday when we were teaching Revelation a clip from Greta Van Susteren off of Fox News, where she showed a picture of all those ISIS characters lining those people up with hoods on, about to behead them. And she called for one leader to stand up. For all the nations to come together and for one leader to please stand up. I'm not trying to say Greta knows exactly what she's doing and that she's part of the system. I don't know. It could be. What I am trying to say is that she's over there looking at the picture and fear is already striking her heart. She's disturbed. She says we need one man to stand up. We need one man to stand up. We need nations to come together and to do what it is that we need them to do in order to eradicate the earth of this evil, just like it was in Nazi Germany. And what I'm here to tell you is that if you think that's bad, wait till it starts striking the soil of America and it comes close to her home. Now, the interesting thing is that it was either that night that I preached it or that day and I didn't know about it that ISIS struck in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and did what they did to those Marines. So the reality of it is that to some extent it's already trying to touch our soil. Right now we're still asleep. Right now we're still asleep, and kind of like what it says in Revelation 17, like the harlot, we're drunk with the intoxication of her fornication. We're still just walking around kind of like in a little bit of a slumber. But Lord, help us, because if it comes worse, we're not going to be asleep for long.
No.
We're going to start waking up.
Amen.
And we're going to start realizing that there's an organized, listen to me, we're back at the giants. The enemy of our soul has a plan. Sons of God came into the daughters of men, produced these Nephilim giants, and they have been arch enemies of Israel in the midst of the land. And if you go back and you read, even in the conquest of Joshua, giant after giant after giant, there's David holding up Goliath's head. He was a giant also. He was a Nephilim. The people of God have been fighting against the plan of the enemy. And in this sense, it was physical fight, but in our sense, it's a spiritual fight. I personally believe this is where the demon spirits come from. The disembodied spirits from these Nephilim creatures. That's my opinion. You find another place in the Bible that explains it better. See, demon spirits are different than fallen angels. Fallen angels don't need a body. They have a celestial body. They can shapeshift. But yet demon spirits are constantly looking for a body in which they can inhabit.
Amen.
Nevertheless, God told the children of Israel, you go in and you destroy them all because they have a seed in them that needs to be destroyed. So the next time somebody tells you that you serve a God that hates people, say, no, you don't know about the Nephilim. You don't know about the fallen angels and the daughters of men. You need to go back and you need to read Genesis 6. God doesn't want that seed mixing with his seed. See, their plan was, you remember in the garden? Why would they do such a thing? What did God tell them in the garden? God told the serpent, he said, the seed of the woman will crush your head. So now the plan of the serpent is to destroy the seed of the woman, make a hybrid race, change the genetics of it. Most scholars believe that that's why what it means by Noah was blameless in all his generation, meaning that he did not have that genetic structure in him or his family. All right, that's another story for another time. Nevertheless, Rahab the harlot said, we heard what you did to Og of Bashan. And the scripture says right here, giants must be defeated. And I'm talking spiritually in your own life. You got to remember that. Well, name some giants in my life, preacher. Some people struggle with addictions. Some people struggle with addictions and that they have these giants in their lives and they cannot get past them and they keep reoccurring. And listen to me, many times on this side of the Jordan you struggle in your wilderness experience, but I need you to understand when you cross over Jordan and you meet Jericho, then listen, those strongholds are still going to try to show up.
Amen.
I constantly talk about really in the life of single women in the church. I always do this, I can't help myself, forgive me. Don't forgive me, be happy, I tell you. For some reason, single women in the church struggle with relationships with men. It's not just women. Women are struggling for a different reason than the men do. Most times, men are just so bound with lust, all they want is that from the woman, right?
Yeah.
The women in the church are struggling because they need help dependent-wise. They're dependent upon a relationship for various reasons. They've gotten used to living a certain way. And they've gotten used to living a certain way and they need help in that area. They need to learn how to let Jesus be their husband. Amen?
Amen.
Because there's no man on this earth that's going to treat you right like Jesus will treat you right. And the truth of the matter is that if you keep struggling when you cross over Jordan, once you come convinced in your mind that all those things that you were trying to grab a hold of on the other side of Jordan, they're still trying to face you on this side of Jordan, sooner or later you got to come to the place in your life where you're like, you know what? This is the same old story and it's not working. Lord, help me to get a revelation that what I need is you. Amen.
Yes.
And then maybe once you get that revelation, the Lord would send you the right one that's not just looking for the wrong thing. Amen. But would learn to love you and be in love with you for who you really are and love the Jesus that's in you. Amen.
Amen.
All right. That's just some giants that must be defeated in the spiritual realm. But in the physical realm, here you got Deuteronomy 3:11. For only Og, king of Bashan, remained. His bedstead, talking about his bed of iron, was 9 cubits in length. I said 14, that was wrong. And 4 cubits in breadth. What's that?
13 and a half.
Feet.
Yeah.
13 and a half feet. So he's probably about a 12-footer, I guess. You got to have about a foot and a half of length at your foot of your bed, right? And it goes on to say in Joshua 12:4, in the coast of Og, king of Bashan, which was the remnant of the giants that dwelt at Ashtoreth and Edrei. So Rahab the harlot tells us that the reason that the inhabitants are full of fear is because we heard what God did for you when he gave you and you utterly destroyed Og, king of Bashan. 22 times in the Old Testament, Og is mentioned, the defeat of Og is mentioned. It was a paramount victory. Have there ever been victories in your life, amen? Has God given you some victories in your life? He wants you to remember those victories because when you cross over to the other side, there's a Jericho waiting for you. And just as he destroyed Og of Bashan, he can also destroy the Jerichos that are in your life. But listen to me, the inhabitants of Jericho had only heard, I don't have time to preach it anymore, it took up too much time, and only heard about what had happened on the other side. See, the Word of God says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, that God has already given you everything that you need pertaining to life and godliness. But it comes through something called knowledge. Now listen to me, don't get, if you don't understand what you're looking at, you get yourself messed up. It's not just any kind of knowledge, it's epignosis. What does that mean? Gnosis is something that you just learn in a book. Epi means upon. It's upon knowledge. It's added to it. It has an experiential aspect to it. A more full understanding. Right now, the inhabitants of Jericho have heard that there's a God of Israel that can dry up a Red Sea and can destroy Og of Bashan. But they're about to experience with their own eyes the power of God. And you and I, as Christians, need to also understand that it's one thing to hear a preacher say something. It's one thing to read it in the Word of God. But when you begin to experience the power of God moving and operating in your life, as you learn how to keep your faith focused on Jesus and what he did, and you begin to see strongholds taken down in your life, amen, you begin to believe in a whole new way. Because now you've not just heard it, but now you're starting to see it, and you're starting to experience it. What the children of Israel told Rahab is look, you need to put this scarlet thread, that's my first thing I wanted to tell you about, put this scarlet thread outside of your window. When we come back, everybody needs to be in your house, just as on the Passover night. Amen. Just as on Passover night, blood on the door, now there's a scarlet thread outside. Just as on the Passover night, everybody needs to be in the house, everybody needs to be in your house, Rahab. If they're out on the street, their blood is on their own hands. You got to be in the house because the scarlet thread is going to show us. Scarlet thread, man, I'm telling you right now, look, this is the children of Israel. You see the scarlet thread right there? This is Jericho. The walls are about to come down. But what I want you to know is that that scarlet thread, it keeps recurring throughout Scripture. There was scarlet thread on the veil that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies. Amen. They're just as the scarlet is the color of blood. Just as the color of blood was painted on the doorpost of the Exodus house, the scarlet thread hung outside of Rahab the harlot's house. Scarlet thread was woven into the veil which separated man from the presence of God. Scarlet is the color of blood. The Lord said in Leviticus, I've given you blood to make atonement for the soul because the life of the creature is in the blood. Rahab the harlot put her scarlet thread outside the window. The Word of God says in Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. I'm going to read it to you real quick. And having made peace through the blood of his cross. Were you ever at war with God? The Word of God says he made peace through the blood of his cross by him to reconcile. What does that mean? Things were separated. God wants to bring it back together. Through the blood of his cross to reconcile all things unto himself. By him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies. What I need you to understand is that Rahab was an alien. She was an enemy to the things of God. She was a Canaanite that lived in a city called Jericho. She didn't know God, but she took her scarlet thread of faith and she threw it outside of that window, and it represents the blood of the cross. And you need to understand that even though mankind may be separated, God has a plan. Amen. And the good news is this, is that God sent two spies, his people, to tell Rahab, a sinner saved by grace, about the God of Israel that could save her. Now, if you're saved in here this morning, you know what your next job is? To go find a Rahab. Your next job is to go find a Rahab and to let her know, let him know that there's a God of heaven. Amen. And he's in the salvation business. And he wants them to understand that there can be reconciliation, that there can be hope because Jesus shed his blood. That was the first thing I wanted you to see. I wanted you to see, I'm going to hurry up. I'm going to finish this message. Y'all just hang tight. It's not going to be bad, I promise. Point number one, scarlet thread, it was her faith. She put her faith out there, amen? Point number two, the weakness of humanity. You need to understand that you're not going to accomplish it in your own strength. The Word of God says that once a day for 6 days, the children of Israel walked around the city. Six was the day that God created man, the number of man, the number of six. You don't going to tell me that it's coincidental that God told them, once a day for 6 days, I want you to get in formation, put the armed men out in front of you, put the priests with the trumpets and the ark, and I want you to walk around one time. Don't shout, don't blow the trumpet, walk around one time, and you do that once a day for 6 days. 6 days, same thing every time. Nothing happened. God will not allow man to get the glory of his work.
Amen.
Good word.
Come on, somebody. Mankind will continue to try to do it in his own flesh. And when I say flesh, I mean in his own physical strength. He will try to live for God according to a set of rules and regulations. He will go to church more. He will read more. He will get involved in more ministries. But the fact of the matter is that nothing that you can do in your own strength or flesh is going to cause giants to fall, going to cause the walls of Jericho to fall. It's going to be your faith in what God provided that gives you access and open heaven, a ladder where the presence of God is ascending and descending upon you to give you the strength that you need. It's only going to be through that scarlet thread. It's only going to be through that blood that was shed. It's only going to be through faith in what Jesus has done. But man will keep on doing it. He'll keep trying. Adam realized his nakedness and he tried to cover himself with fig leaves. God said, that's not going to work. It takes an innocent animal and he covers it. It requires the death of the innocent to pay the price of the guilty. Not only would it be Adam, but Abraham. Whenever time tarries and the child of promise doesn't come forth, he takes the bondwoman and he tries to take things in his own hands and he produces Ishmael to try to bring about the plan of God. You can't do it that way, Abraham. We're still dealing with Ishmael today. Not only that, but Jacob. Jacob puts a fur on his arm and says that he's Esau, trying to bring about the plan of God according to his own logic and his own strength. Can't do it that way, Jacob. It's going to cause you problems. Esau's going to find you in the wilderness. He's going to put fear in your heart. All these things, Moses. Moses was called as the deliverer of the children of Israel, and he tries to do it in his own strength. The Bible says he looked to the right, he looked to the left, he killed that Egyptian, and he buried him in the sand. That's not how you're going to deliver Israel, Moses.
No.
God's going to have to go before you, and he's going to have to do the work. He'll send the plagues on Pharaoh's house. He's going to reveal to Pharaoh who's God,
yes.
Amen, and who is man. And all he's asking you to do is to open up your stuttering mouth and to speak forth what he's asking you to speak forth. That's why God would use a little shepherd boy. Instead of a king who the Bible said stood head and shoulders, Saul, above the rest of the inhabitants of Israel.
Right.
Saul's cowering in the camp, and he tries to get David to do it his way. He wants to put his armor on David. No. God uses a little shepherd boy in a sling. Somebody pointed out to me here recently, did you realize that Goliath fell on his face? I went back and I looked. He fell on his face. You would think that, listen to me, it takes some force. You got to have some serious force swinging out of that sling for that rock to kill a giant like that. Hit him in the head. You think for 1 second that if that rock hit you in the head, I don't care how big you are, that it wouldn't cause your head to jerk back? Now, what's the natural tendency if your head jerks back? Your body's going to follow. But the Bible explicitly says that Goliath fell on his face.
Right.
It wasn't just it was the rock called Jesus that knocked him down, but it was the hand of God. And the little shepherd boy is not going to get the glory. Hallelujah. It's the God behind the little shepherd boy. And while everybody in Israel might say, oh, David, Saul killed his thousands and David killed his tens of thousands, at the same time when David faced the giant, he said, you come at me with spirit sore, but I come at you in the name of the Lord. David knew where his strength came from. You and I need to remember where our strength comes from. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Scarlet thread, don't forget. Faith in Christ. Number two, the weakness of humanity. You're not going to get it done once a day for 6 days, they walked around and nothing happened. On the seventh day, oh, hallelujah. On the seventh day, seven times, seven priests, seven trumpets, yes. And the Ark of the Covenant.
Praise
God. The presence of God.
Yes.
I keep preaching about the Ark. I know that people probably get tired of it, but the reality of it is that it's throughout the Scriptures.
That's right.
Because God wants to remind His people about the presence of God. What's so important about the Ark? Some of you can take a nap, but the rest of you that haven't been with us, you need to be reminded. The Ark of the Covenant represents the place where God promised to dwell with His people. He said, you will build me an ark. It will be of a shit of wood or acacia wood, and it will be overlaid with gold. And upon this mercy seat, there will be two cherubim. And once a year, there will be blood applied to the mercy seat. But it's between the cherubim that my presence will rest, and I will commune with you. God's presence rested between those cherubim, and here's seven priests, and they're carrying the ark, or whoever, however many priests are carrying the ark, and there's seven priests with trumpets, and on the seventh day, seven times, seven priests, seven blasts of a trumpet, and the shout from the inhabitants of Israel, and the walls came down. Hallelujah. You and I need to understand that if we want to see Jericho's fall in our lives, we're going to have to trust in the presence of God. And it once again goes back to the shedding of blood that allows you and I to have access to the presence of God. Amen. God wants to go before us in the battle. He wants to give us victory in the battle. Hallelujah. And I got to tell you, I'm going to close with this. There's also going to be another shout on the future. A day when the trumpet of God and the shout of the archangel of God, hallelujah, and listen to me, just as the walls of Jericho stood between the children of Israel and their promise, there's a wall called gravity that's going to lose its hold, amen, and the children of God are going to be released, amen, into the presence of the living God. I'm telling you, the word of God says that there will be a rapture of the church.
Praise you.
God's going to deliver His people. I believe that. Don't think that America's going to stay the same way until then, though. I'm a different kind of preacher than the one down the street.
Yep.
I'm not going to tell you everything's going to be hunky-dory until that day comes. But I will tell you this. The same God that Rahab trusted in is the same God you and I trust in.
Amen.
The same God that Paul trusted in is the same God that you and I can trust in.
Yes.